world is constantly evolving. As time moves forward, things change, which is why it's important to stay informed. Throughout the year, there are dozens of professionals that share their expertise with the community through lectures sponsored by local government agencies and area not-for-profits. And each month, we'll feature one of these visiting professors as they discuss the latest current events and trends. So grab a notebook and pull up a chair because the lecture hall is about to begin.
So today I'm going to be talking about biofuels and what our microbes can do for us. So we're going to be going through a whole bunch of different topics, but hopefully at the end it'll all make sense. I am from Harbor Branch. Have any of you been up to Harbor Branch? Yep, some of you have been to Harbor Branch. We're just north of Fort Pierce. We were founded in 1971. We employ about 100 and something people. We're on a 500-acre campus, and we were an independent research organization right up until the beginning of last year, January 2008, we became a campus of Florida Atlantic University. So that's really beneficial to us. It gives us stability. It increases our whole education sector, and we're growing. We're always growing. So what I'm going to be talking about this morning falls into the biofuels area. So I'll start talking about what biofuels are. How do we make biofuels? How are they made from things like various types of biomass? And then we're going to switch gears and talk about my topic, which is marine microorganisms and how do they fit into the whole biomass biofuel arena. And then I'll talk about some of our recent research and where we're trying to go. Okay, so why do we need renewable fuel sources? The first basic question. And the one that impacts us all is this, okay? This was like a year ago when fuel prices went through the roof and everyone went, we need a new fuel source. We can't rely on gasoline anymore because it's costing us an arm and a leg. But we have major impacts of the fuel crisis, as it were. Why do we need new fuels? Well, firstly, of course, the economy. And petroleum imports are the largest single part of our trade deficit. We bring in far more gasoline than we generate in this country. We use 20 million barrels of oil daily. 60% of that is imported. Okay. For transportation, we use 14 to 15 million barrels of that just for moving things around. Okay, so about 75% of what we're using goes into transportation. Interesting fact here, the US has 5% of the world's population, only 2% of the oil reserves, and yet we use 25% of the petroleum produced worldwide. Because of that, there are major issues related to energy security. So yes, we're importing most of our fuels, but what happens when China, India, they're growing economies. So they're going to start using more and more fuel. They're going to start taking away a portion of the fuels that we're trying to get. And so there's no longer a major secure market out there for the US to be able to get petroleum from overseas. Also impacts on homeland security. If somehow our petroleum access is cut off, then you can have a devastating effect on the US economy. And finally, there's the effect on the environment. By using fossil fuels, you're generating greenhouse gases. So you're taking old carbon, which has been fixed millions of years ago, burning it and releasing the CO2 from the fossil fuels. 2004 figure, 1.9 billion tons of CO2 released. That increased, or is predicted to increase to 2.7 billion tons in 2030. So what are biofuels? Where do they come from? And how do we make them? Try to address some of those questions. Well, biofuels are renewable fuels which are derived from plant material. So crops, we can grow crops, we can make fuels out of them. And the fuels we're looking at are things such as ethanol, butanol, the alcohols. We're looking at biodiesel and biogas. And I'll mention biogas in passing only. Most of this discussion will be on the alcohols and biodiesel. So what are the benefits of going to biofuels? Well, we can look at the slide I just put up about the problems, and we can theoretically answer at least some of these issues by going to biofuels. Firstly, we're enhancing our national energy security. If we can grow the crops and make fuels out of them, then we're not relying on foreign imports. Same reason, we're improving our trade balance, because again, we're generating fuel, we're not bringing it in from outside. And we can decrease the greenhouse gas emission because we're recycling the CO2. You're taking new growth of plants, turning that into fuel, which releases CO2. Plants use CO2 to grow. You're not taking the old carbon of fossil fuels and burning that up. So we're going to talk about alcohols, so bioethanol, making ethanol from plants. Interesting fact again, 140 billion gallons of transportation fuels is used annually in the US. Huge amount of fuel just to get things moving around. In 2006, the US produced 5 billion gallons of ethanol, mostly from corn. This was used as a 10% blend with gasoline. If ever you fill up your car, you look at the little sign, it says may contain up to 10% ethanol. This is bioethanol. This is using crops to make the ethanol that can add to the gasoline, okay? Government, a couple of years ago, made a goal, okay? By 2030, we need to displace 30% of the nation's gasoline with ethanol. So we need to markedly move up the amount of ethanol which is being used by 2030. So 30% by 30 was the goal. And you can see if we're only making 5 billion gallons at the moment, we need to be able to make 60 billion gallons by 2030 to reach that goal. So we need a large amount of ethanol being added to the market. Brazil, nice little country down in South America. But they are the poster child for ethanol production. And they are using pure ethanol to fuel 90% of the new cars that they produce. So they're just taking ethanol, they've modified the engines, they can use ethanol to do this. They're using blends of up to 25% in the older cars. So whereas we're using 10%, they're using 25%. Their production is 3.8 billion gallons a year, which satisfies 40% of Brazil's fuel consumption. Their market is far smaller than ours. They are not the US. So they're making less ethanol than we do per year, and yet they're satisfying 40% of the fuel consumption. They're also encouraging ethanol production consumption by making it a lot cheaper than gasoline. So buying ethanol, 65% the price of gasoline. So where are they getting all this ethanol from? And in Brazil, what they're doing is making it from sugar cane. They have a large amount of sugar cane. They have the sugar to be able to make ethanol directly from that. How is ethanol made? Well, it's a very simple fermentation process. You all know about wine, beer, whiskey. They're all made by fermentation of some sort of sugar source using a yeast. The yeast takes the sugars, turns them into alcohol, which we use to enjoy. You can use the same process to make ethanol for fuel sources. You're just taking a sugar source, you're fermenting it up with a yeast or a bacterium, turning it into ethanol. The issue comes with what do you use as your sugar source. So in Brazil, we talked about this one, they're using sugar. Sugar cane juice, that's a very simple sugar solution which can then be fermented to make ethanol. Most of the world, that doesn't work too well because you're not growing a vast excess of sugar to be able to do this. And so in many cases, people have moved one step further up to look at starch. So starches, which can then be broken down by enzymes, proteins, which catalyze reactions, into simple sugars, which can then be fermented. The issue with starch sources, if you look at what they are, things like corn, wheat, grain, rice, potatoes. What do they have in common with other things we do? We use them as a food source. So you've got an immediate competition between production of ethanol for a fuel source and food, which can be eaten. So depending upon what good price the farmers can get, the food resource can decrease because things are being sidetracked off into fuel production. So a lot of places, including the European Union, has actually banned any research on biofuels based on food sources. Okay? So the next step up the ladder is to go to cellulosic biomass, which is things which are not used as food. They're the leaves, they're the switchgrass, they're the stalks, they're the byproducts of all of the food industry, and things which just cannot be used as a food source. So what we're trying to do is avoid this situation. Okay? We don't want all our food to disappear simply because it went for ethanol production. Okay? So what are we using as a source of biomass for alcohol production? Well, as I mentioned, leaves, stalks, stems, things which can't eat. So agricultural residues, agricultural waste. There's a lot of interest in Florida in using citrus peel as a potential source of biomass for fuel production. You take the juice, you have the peel left over. Some of it is used for feeding livestock, but there's a lot of it out there. You can use industrial waste. You can use things like sawdust, paper pulp, whatever. Anything which is biological, which contains a lot of sugars, complex sugars, can be turned into simple sugars and then into bioethanol. Solid waste. So if you can take newspapers, do something with those, away you go into fuel. And then dedicated energy crops. So rather than growing up a crop specific, which could be food, and then using the byproduct for energy production, you can grow up a specific crop. So switchgrass, which grows very rapidly, it grows on land which really can't be used for any other agricultural purpose. So then you can start getting a crop which can be harvested for energy production. All of these things contain a large quantity of sugar in the form of what's called lignocellulose. So it's cellulose, it's woody cellulose. It's something which has to be broken down into a usable form. And the way that is done at the moment, in most cases, is using heat and acid. So you're really digesting the stuff up chemically and turning it into the simple sugars. The problem with that is by having to use heat to do this process, you're having to put energy into a system to be able to make something you can use as a source of energy. By adding the acid, you're adding something which you have to get rid of in the end. So you have potential pollution problems. So we need new ways of processing this material to be able to use it in fuel production. Another alcohol which can be used for biofuel is a thing called biobutanol. And this is something probably people haven't heard about, but it's a larger alcohol. Ethanol is just 2 carbon units, butanol is 4 carbon units. But it has 1/3 higher energy density than ethanol, okay? It doesn't require engine modification. If you're using ethanol, motors tend not to like it too much. Actually, the gaskets don't like it terribly much. So you have to modify the engine, but butanol is far more friendly, and you can use up to 40% of the total fuel from butanol. It can be transported. The issue with ethanol that seems to be out there is transportation. Ethanol tends to absorb water. It becomes corrosive in certain situations, and so existing pipelines can become damaged by transporting ethanol. Tanker trucks can have problems with that as well. There's stories about transportation of ethanol in pipelines, which may well be apocryphal, but what it's said is if you get a leak in an ethanol pipeline, you can soon find it because the farm workers are all around there drunk. So they sort of find these leaks and then, okay, we've got a party going on here. So, you know, you have issues of security of ethanol pipelines. You don't see that with butanol. No one wants to drink butanol. Butanol production is done by fermentation, this time with a bacterium called Clostridium, and it's fermentation of sugars. So this is something where there's a lot of research trying to find efficient ways of making this compound as a future fuel. Then biodiesel, okay? Gasoline, petroleum, contains hydrocarbons of various chain lengths. Regular diesel is made up of alkanes and hydrocarbons like this. Biodiesel is actually a different chemical compound. It's alkyl fatty esters. and they're this sort of length. So it's fatty esters are actually made from used cooking oils. So you've heard about running your car on chip fat. This is exactly what we're talking about here. So used cooking oils, animal fats, and then plant oils, which can't be used as a food source. You don't want to have to put soybean oil in your car because you've got a very expensive product there, which is used for other purposes. But there are some plants which make large amounts of oil, and in this case, Jatropha. This one contains toxic compounds. You know, it's not a good oil. It's bitter, it contains toxic compounds. It can't be used as a food source, okay? So these things require modification in the presence of methanol, strong alkali, and heat. So again, you've got the problem of having to put energy into the system, you've got a pollutant, and you're adding various other things to the system to be able to make the fuel. So biodiesel production in the US, 2.4 billion gallons worldwide. In the States, 200 million gallons were made, but 65 billion gallons of diesel oil were used. And the good thing about diesel is it can be used as pure form in diesel engines. It's generally used as a diesel additive. So you're adding some of the diesel to biodiesel to be able to modify what you're putting into your car or truck. Okay. So summarize what I've spoken about so far. Cellulose, hemicellulose, lignin. The lignoselluloses, which are present in all these plants, have to be broken down to the free sugars, which can then be converted to fuels by fermentation. Plant oils have to be broken down to fatty acids in generating biodiesel. The way we do that at the moment is using chemical breakdown to give the desired product. This requires input of heat, generates pollutants, okay? Now then, this is where we get to my area. Microorganisms. Microorganisms have this really great ability to make enzymes, and they put them outside of their cell so as they are chewing up things that are in their environment and using them as a food source. So you can find microbes that carry out a lot of different processes just to be able to do this food capture from the environment. If we can find microbes which make enzymes which carry out these processes, we would have a highly efficient, specific mechanism for fuel production. Okay? So that's the whole theory behind what I'm trying to do at the moment. Okay, microbes. Microbes are found all over the planet. They're found in the high atmosphere. There was a report recently that I read where some microbes had been discovered in the extreme outer regions of the stratosphere, and they were a novel genus species, and there was some debate as to whether they come from somewhere in the elsewhere in the universe. I doubt that very much, but They're certainly in the very high atmosphere, they're in the oceans, they're in deep rocks, they're all over the place. It's microbes which keep the life cycles of the Earth turning. So they're very, very important to us. So what sort of things are we talking about in terms of microorganisms? We're talking about algae, diatoms, for example, protozoans, things like amoebae. We're talking about fungi, the microscopic fungi. You see this if you eat blue cheese. Penicillium's in there. It's that blue vein all the way through the thing. We're talking about bacteria. Hopefully you haven't suffered with that one, Streptococcus pneumoniae. We're talking about things called the archaea. These things look like bacteria, but they're actually found in places like deep sea hydrothermal vents. And they're very much adapted to living in those environments, so they can live in very high temperatures, high pH, low pH environments. And also, the viruses, which are also microorganisms. So you're dealing with a whole slew of different types of microbes which exist in our planet. They're very diverse. I like putting, this is the two that I concentrate on, the fungi and the bacteria. That's most of my work is done on fungi and bacteria. I like to put this up. This is a graph which shows how diverse life is on this planet. And it's based on the molecular phylogeny of one part of the DNA, which is found in all creatures. And this is the part of the DNA that makes protein. the ribosomal DNA. Interesting thing about this chart is that here you can see these are the bacteria. These are the archaea, things which look like bacteria but aren't. And then if we look down this way, we have all the eukaryotes, which are all the things which have nuclei. And if you come down here, these are all microbes, these are all microbes, these are all microbes, these are all microbes. And then about this point here, you get into the higher plants and animals. Okay, so the periphera, yeah. Zea is the maize plant, man, and the mushroom. So we're down here somewhere. But if you look at the rest of this, so 99% of life on Earth, the diversity of life on Earth is microbial. Of course, this was put together by a microbiologist, but you know, it just shows you just how diverse microbial life is on this planet. So I work on marine microbes. The reason for that is if we look at any new habitat on this planet, we find new microorganisms. Okay, so we're constantly finding new microbes. They adapt to their environmental conditions. So you can see certain changes in them based on where they're found. And they produce lots of extracellular enzymes, which is what we're looking for. Okay, so this was a preliminary study looking for biomass converting enzymes from marine microbes. So what we did, we went out, we collected samples by scuba off of Palm Beach County. We collected them in the Bahamas and by submersible also in the Bahamas. Hubbard Branch operates a ship and a research sub. We can get down to 3,000 feet of depth and collect samples at those sort of depths. So with this, we inoculated petri dishes, allowed them to grow, and then tested the microbes to see whether they have the ability to break down biomass. Okay, the enzyme tests that we did were looking for things which break down cellulose, so cellulases, lipases, which break down plant oils, and chitinases, which break down chitin. And the reason I'm interested in that is in the marine environment, there's a huge amount of chitin. It's the exoskeleton of crabs, lobsters, shrimp, all those things. And something out there must be breaking these things down. If we can break down chitin, again, we get to simple sugars, which could be made into biofuels. So this was something which was sort of a let's see what happens type of experiment. To be able to test for cellulase, what we do is we grow microbes in the presence of cellulose. Okay, so over time, up to 3 days, those things just grow up. And you can't really see any change in the plate. But what we can do is then stain the plates, and we get a nice halo around any of the microbes which have cellulase activity. So that's what it looks like in a cartoon. That's what it looks like in real life. Okay, so very similar, it's very obvious where you can see these activities. Same thing with lipase. In this case, we're using soybean oil, and we incubate them for 3 days, they grow up. And then we look at this under UV light, and we can again see a halo of fluorescence, and this is what that looks like. So again, it's very obvious where the lipase activity is on these plates. Chitin, same sort of thing. Grow them up, let them grow, can't see anything until you put them under UV light. And then you can see that there are shadows around the ones which are active, okay? The rest of the chitin has not been broken down. The calcifluor that's in there is causing the fluorescence. If you break down the chitin, you can see the halo, okay? So we did this, well, we would do that and look at everything, but each of those assays kills the bugs that you're looking at. So you can't just sort of, okay, I'm gonna run the assay and then pick out which ones are giving the activity. You have to do it indirectly. And we do that using a technique called replica plating. And in this, it's just like stamping. So you've all stamped things with ink onto pieces of paper and made replicas. In this case, you take a petri dish with your grown-up bugs and put them onto a piece of velvet, and then you can use that velvet to stamp onto other petri dishes. So here it's got bugs on it, you get velvet on here, it goes onto another petri dish, and then you can do tests on that other one, okay? So for this, we inoculated using the samples that we collected in Palm Beach County, and we let them incubate. Come on, you can do it, incubate. for weeks, months, whatever, and eventually stuff grows up. And it's random stuff. You know, we got a lot of different types of bacteria, and even though that's a cartoon, that is what it looks like in real life. So it's very similar. These are just environmental samples. This is actually from a sponge. And you put it onto a petri dish and you let it grow and you get lots of different bacteria, all different colors and shapes and whatever, okay? And that's all very well and good, but you want to work out what it can do. So we go through the whole process of replica plating and then doing the assay on those replica plates, and this is what we see, okay? So you start out, you have your mother plate, you make a replica of it, which we can then use to do the isolation work. We then test the same things for lipase, cellulase, chitinase, and you can see the zones, the rings around the ones which are active, and then we can correlate those back to here to be able to isolate the actual microbe which gives that activity. And in some cases, some of these colonies may well have more than one activity. This one has cellulase and lipase, okay? So this is a lot of data. But we took several sediment samples, a sample of an alga called Caulerpa, and two sponges, Discodermia, which is very, very close to my heart. I worked on it for many, many years, one from a deep water environment, one from shallow water. Discodermia is very interesting because it makes an anti-cancer compound, which we've worked on for many years. But we then tested these, as I said, for cellulase, lipase, and chitinase activity, and looked for the percentage of colonies which were present which had those activities. And it's interesting to see that for lipase activity, absolutely everything that we grew had lipase activity from the Caulerpa, from the alga. So you have an awful lot of these things which are giving the activity which could be used in making biodiesel. If you look for the cellulase activity, we're seeing this from the sponges. So why? How are they there? You know, what are they? And we went through the process of working out what each of these bacteria was. If you get 100% of the things on a plate showing up active against lipase, it could be that you've got just one thing growing up many, many, many times over. But we did the taxonomy on each of those colonies, and it's actually a lot of different things. So we're seeing what are called gram-positive bacteria. We're seeing gram-negative bacteria. And the really interesting thing is that if you look at this, these only match to something called uncultured marine bacterium. Uncultured marine bacterium. So these are bacteria which have not been seen by science before. So by finding truly novel bacteria with these activities, we're probably finding new enzymes, which can then be used in the whole process of making biofuels. From the sponge, the Discodermia, this was very interesting as well, and something we're going to follow up on. But the deep water Discodermia had these three isolates, which showed activity. They're all gram negatives. They're all alpha proteobacteria. Again, uncultured, not really defined, so things which are very novel. We have some cellulase activity here. But if we look at the shallow water specimen, we see the same microbes here. These three are exactly the same as these ones. But the shallow water specimen also had several other microbes associated with it. So you're seeing some gram-positive things called actinomycetes. You're seeing gram-positive bacteria down here, which come from the shallow water sponge. So lots of different things showing up, lots of things for us to pursue. So this is the Harbor Branch ship, the Seward Johnson, which we use for all our sub-ops. This is the JSL, a four-man submersible, which goes down to 3,000 feet and has a variety of collecting tools on the front. So as when we see something at depth, we can collect it and put it into one of the baskets or the buckets on the front of the sub here. We're interested in sponges, and I'm interested in sponges because if you look, this is an electron micrograph through a part of a sponge. They're full of microorganisms, absolutely full. 60% of a sponge can be microbial. So we take these sponges, we grind them up, we make master plates, just as we talked about earlier, and grow up the bacteria. And we also go through the process of isolating, purifying all these different types of bacteria out of these sponges. We then use those for drug discovery and enzyme discovery. We build up one of the largest culture collections of marine microorganisms, which is in this country. There's about 19,000 microbes in our collection now. And they comprise a lot of different bacteria, things called actinomycetes, which are very interesting in drug discovery. and also microscopic fungi. So down the bottom here, that's a fungus like you'd probably see in your fridge once in a while. And these are various types. This is a bacterium, and this is an actinomycete. Okay. And it's got a lot of diversity to it. So our culture collection contains lots of different types of bacteria, and very many of the bacteria are new to science. But we wanted to see whether we could see any of these enzyme activities from our culture collection bugs. So rather than going into the environment and getting things specifically for enzyme discovery, we decided that we would take stuff out of the culture collection and just see what sort of activities we could find randomly picking microbes. And this is a very small subset, but you can see that we took the microbes, we tested them for the three enzyme activities, and then looked to see where did we collect these things from, what depth did we get them from, and what was the temperature where these things were actually isolated. And you can see here that for these ones, what is interesting is that these things were all isolated from sponges growing in deep water environments at low temperatures. So anywhere from 10 to 12 degrees centigrade. And they have lots of activities against lipases, some cellulase activity, and chitinase activity. And what does that mean in discovery of enzymes? Well, microbes adapt to the place where they're found. And so what is probably going to happen is that the enzymes which are associated with these microbes are also adapted to the place where they're found. So if they're very happy at these very cold water temperatures or fairly cold water temperatures, you're probably going to find a lipase or a chitinase which likes to work at room temperature or below. So you're going to find things which are processing biomass which do not require a heat input to be able to do their job. The other interesting point on here is here. These are from shallow-ish environments off the coast of Florida, 20 to 25 degrees, again, about room temperature. But again, lipase, chitinase, cellulase activities. So these are from the environment right around here. They're Florida microbes, and they are doing what we're hoping they will do. So where are we going next? This is all very new work. So we're trying to think, where do we go to next? First step is going to be to purify the enzymes out of these microbes. We then want to be able to test them in real-world situations. So, you know, we're trying to work with people who generate citrus peel, and can we break these citrus peel down using our enzymes, using our microbes to get into a sugar situation? Can we use the lipases to break down chip fat oil? And we're looking for a company who can get involved with us so as we can take these things to actual development. The other thing I'm going to talk about briefly is alternative sources for biomass. You know, we've been talking about things which grow on land, terrestrial plants. Any terrestrial plants that you're growing up are going to take up real estate. You know, they're going to take away either from food crop, agricultural resources, or they're going to be competing with other development of land. So one of the projects at Harbor Branch is looking at marine plants, so algae. If we can grow algae as a source of biomass for biofuels, it can be grown in the sea. You're not going to be using land to be able to do this. And this was a project which Harbor Branch explored back in the 1970s. There was a fuel crisis back then, which many of us remember. It was rough, and there was a lot of interest in alternative fuels back then. So this was Dennis Hanasak's work, looking at growing marine algae as a potential source of biomass for fuels. And any of you who visited Harbor Branch, this is the old aquaculture facility. This is the canal where the ships dock, and this is the aquaculture facility. And out on the back of here, there are a series of tanks which were specifically produced to be able to grow up these algae in large quantities. And the sort of things they're looking at are things like Gracilaria, this alga, which is also used for agar production, and ulva. So several of these marine algae which can be grown up in large quantities. But this is very interesting in terms of over the course of a year, so January through December, you can grow these algae year-round down here. There's not a problem with very huge seasonality to growth. So both Ulva and Gracilaria, you can grow them year round producing biomass. And this is where biogas comes into the issue. I mentioned biogas, that's production of methane. But what they were doing with these algae was growing them up, harvesting them, and then digesting them to produce methane, okay? And the waste material was going back into the Gracilaria tanks. So it was a closed system, being able to generate fairly large amounts of methane. So near-term goals of all this are to test diverse microbes for applications in biomass, characterize the enzymes, restore active research in marine biomass production, and find funding sources, which is our critical thing. And there is a lot of money at the moment in alternative energies. So we're hoping that this is already going to take off and go somewhere. I need to acknowledge people who did the work, Dee Harmody. Kim Lewis Dee Harmody works with me as a technician. Kim Lewis was an intern. So she came to Harbor Branch for 10 weeks, did a research project, which gave a fair amount of this data. And then Shanti Ross worked as a volunteer in my lab for about 3 or 4 months, and again, generated a vast amount of data. Scott Hurley, Chip Bamberger, collected the algae for our research, and Dr. Dennis Hanasak for all the algal biomass work. It's his project. And finally, I need to mention the shark plate, Save Our Seas. This research was actually funded from money which came from the shark plate. So if you're out there looking for a really attractive plate that can go on the back of your car, it's a small donation to science, but the money really does go back into research, and we do get to use it and produce valuable data, okay? So with that, I'll say thank you.